Yeah. You're from Hello. Welcome to Wanda's Cafe, the show where where guests stop by and talk about issues concerning the community. And today we have someone who I invited to stop by because this is such an issue that's so important in the community where I live in Glendale. And it's probably very important to the communities outside of Glendale that I know I've worked with some of those communities. And this is about the Armenian community, the history, and we hear a lot about the Armenian Genocide. I want to know why the Armenian Genocide. I was running for office and I wanted I asked them, why don't you say Armenian history? And I'm going to ask Dr. Marashlian about that, but a lot of the people in the community don't know a lot about the history because I don't think we've actually dealt with the history. I think we've dealt with the diversity part of it. So I have someone here with me who I know can shed light on some of those issues, and hopefully I can ask him some of the questions that some of the members of the community have. I want to welcome Dr. Levon Marashlian.
Thank you. Thank you, Wanda.
He's a professor of history at Glendale Community College. Not here representing Glendale Community College, but I wanted you here as an expert because I wanted to ask some questions. And if I ask some questions that are difficult or may seem a little bit pushy and intrusive, it's because these are questions that the community members have said to me, asked me, or some seem to be concerned about, and so some of them are not necessarily my questions. They're their questions. Okay, tell me, we may go back and forth, but the one thing that has always interested me is that we hear about a genocide, but I wanna know if a group of people there is something that somebody wants. I want to know what was it that they wanted, because there had to have been something outstanding that someone would want to come in and be intrusive and invade
and commit a genocide.
Uh-huh. Right. Tell me. Start with the history of that. Hmm.
Okay. Well, that's a big question. In terms of history, Armenians have been around a long time. They first formed as a people around 1000 BC. And in the area of what is today, I think a lot of your viewers would know, is Eastern Turkey, around Eastern Turkey, north of Syria, north of Iraq. That area was where the Armenians took form as a nation. And from 1000 BC to 1375 AD, Armenians had four independent kingdoms. So they were around during the times of the Hittites, during the times of Alexander the Great. Alexander the Great and Cleopatra one time tried to install one of their offspring on the Armenian throne. Armenians were around when Emperor Nero was playing his fiddle while Rome was burning. Armenians were there when the Crusades went into the Middle East. In fact, they used Armenia as a staging area to regroup and refresh their horses and get supplies and everything. So Armenians have been around a long time. Between when the Armenians lost their kingdom in 1375, they came under the domination of an empire called the Ottoman Turkish Empire.
And then that was in when?
Well, that was after 1375, but approximately Armenians came under the Ottoman Turkish Empire in the early 1500s. So from the early 1500s until the 20th century, Armenians lived in this Ottoman Turkish Empire. Inside of an empire. So the Armenian homeland was invaded by Turkic invaders whose original home is in Central Asia. Mm-hmm. Turks originally are from Central Asia. And they came into the Middle East a few centuries earlier before that, and eventually they established a powerful kingdom and a powerful empire. So what happened is Turkish conquerors came into Armenia and eventually became the dominant political force in that area. So in the period when the genocide took place in the 20th century, by then Armenians had been living under Turkish rule for several hundred years. And when you ask the reason why a genocide would happen, why it happened, the reason is this. For centuries, Armenians and other Christians in the Ottoman Empire.
I understand
were
that the Armenians were, if I'm interpreting it correctly, Armenians were the first Christians.
Yes, not the first Christians. Jesus was the first Christian.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you're right. Armenians were not the first Christians, but in 301 AD, Armenia became the first kingdom to officially adopt Christianity as a state religion. So Armenians were the first to adopt Christianity as a state religion. And this was a bold move. There were a lot of reasons for it. And Rome adopted it a couple of decades later. So by being Christian in a Muslim empire, they had to be second-class citizens. Okay. Not just Armenians, Greeks and and others were second-class citizens. Yes. Their testimony was not accepted in court. They had to pay extra taxes. They could not ride horses, they could only ride mules. And you see the reason for that. It's to make you feel like something less.
A second-class
citizen.
Yes, second-class
citizen, exactly. And one of the taxes Armenians had to pay, for example, was something called the defshirme tax, and that was a tax Armenians paid in the form of little boys. The government would go around, village to village, and they did this for about 150 years, and as a form of taxation, they would go to Armenian families, also Greeks, Bulgarians, others, and take out your boys.
And when you take them out for the war? Or
at the age of like 5 or 7, so the official would look at the, you know, let's say a family has 4 boys, he would pick the best one. The official would pick the best one, the healthiest looking one, the smartest looking one, the most handsome one, and take him and take that little boy, let's say 5, 6 years old, away from the family, never to be seen again.
And where would he go?
He would be put into a Turkish family, into a foster family, converted to Islam, raised as a Turk, okay? And eventually, as he grows up, he would be in an elite army corps, something like the Green Beret.
But does he know that he is Armenian?
Well,
is he brainwashed and
well, he's
then
converted. So
converted.
What happens is, so at that age, your family background is programmed out of you. Mm-hmm. And eventually, you become a Muslim, you become Turkish. And the reason why a little boy like that, when he grows up, he would know that at one time he was Christian, is because you are installed into an elite military corps, equivalent to maybe our Green Beret. Mm-hmm. It was called the Janissary Corps, the elite army, elite unit in the Ottoman army. So only Christians.
So Janissary Corps meaning the beginning corps or something?
No, it's it means new troops. Yeniçeri in Turkish, new troops.
Okay,
so they're the best fighters, the elite fighting force for the empire. They all have to be previous Christians. So you knew you were a Christian. Mm. But you don't know where your village is. You don't know. You never see your parents again. Now, this was a form of taxation. So those boys taken would be slaves of the government. They were slaves, but sort of like
indentured servant types.
Indentured servant, like privileged slaves, in a sense that they're given the best food, the best education, and they're put into an army corps that's the best paid. You're owned by the government. You fight for the government. But if you have, if you're extra smart or something, you might be put into school. For example, the most famous architect in all of Turkish history is a man named Sinan Pasha. Mm-hmm. He was Armenian and or Greek.
Why do you say and or?
Because we know that the village he came from was a mixed population of Armenian and Greek.
So they did begin to intermarry?
Once that converted Armenian grows up, he eventually would marry a Turkish woman. And eventually their offspring would be Turks. So what this did after centuries of doing this, it depletes the Armenian population, increases the Turkish population.
Okay.
So and it was a form of taxation. One day you give money or wheat, another day you give one of your sons.
So they actually taxed you not just for the sons, but for
other things as well.
That was just one form.
Right, one form. There are all kinds of
And this
taxation.
Lasted from the 1500s?
Right. By the 1800s, Armenians were accepting this docilely. They had developed like a slave mentality,
passive
and turn the other cheek. And the church would teach Armenians that, look, we're lucky we're alive. If we complain, we might be destroyed. So just kind of go along. At least we're allowed to speak our language. At least we're allowed to stay Christian. So Armenians were very docile. In fact, they were called the loyal community by the Turkish government. But what happened in the 19th century, in the 1800s, is partly because of American Protestant missionaries who went into the Ottoman Empire to convert Muslims to Christianity.
Mm-hmm.
When they learned that that's kind of difficult to do,
yes.
to do, what they saw was there are a couple of million Armenians who are already Christian, but they belong to the wrong church. They don't belong to a Protestant church, they belong to an independent Armenian church. So they began proselytizing among Armenians, converting a lot of them to Protestantism. And along with the Protestant church, of course, goes an American school, an American hospital. So what happened is a lot of Armenians came into contact with Americans, with these missionaries, who in their schools would teach things like the American Constitution, George Washington, freedom of speech. So what happened is some Armenians came to realize, my God, there's a country out there, someplace where you could stand in front of the White House, insult the president, and
still become somebody.
And nothing happens to
nothing
you,
happens
and a police will
you.
Just walk by and just say nothing.
Okay.
Because of this influence, and also because of the influence of the French Revolution of 1789, Armenians began to, they accepted these liberal ideas that today we associate with Americanism, freedom of speech, political parties, and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
In the 1800s, some Armenians began asking for these changes. They asked for equality and democracy and so forth. Now, the Turkish government, which at that time was under the control of a sultan or a king, had no love for democracy. Even Arabs in the empire had no democracy. Mm-hmm. Turks themselves had no democracy. So do you see what happens from the Ottoman government point of view? These Armenians are troublemakers. They're bringing in these radical Western ideas of democracy. Through them, what's happening is Muslims are beginning to learn through the Armenians, since Armenians also know Turkish and so forth. So through the Armenians, these dangerous democratic ideas are coming in. Well, let's go fast forward to World War One.
Right, okay.
What after decades
of living under this suppressive
after centuries of living under a suppressive rule, some Armenians began asking for democratic change.
And so decades went by asking for these changes.
Right. It began roughly the 1830s, okay. 1830s, 40s, 50s, 60s, when the government refused to give those changes. Some Armenians began forming political parties, and they began demanding change now. Not just writing letters, began demanding changes. The same way the American revolutionaries began demanding from King George saw that polite appeals for taxation, for no taxation without representation and so forth failed, they became radicalized. The Sons of Liberty were formed in 1765. They became radicalized. So some Armenians also became revolutionaries, and this resulted in the 1890s, the massacre of about 200,000 Armenians.
And is this the April 24th?
No.
It's
not the genocide yet.
Not the genocide.
Right.
Okay. I didn't think it was.
No, not the genocide yet, but it was a relatively minor massacre. It's only 200,000. That's hard to say, but relatively.
Oh, yeah, only 200,000.
Yeah, compared to what's going to happen later. What happened is in 1914, World War One began. And unfortunately, the Turkish government at that time had become dictatorial. In 1908, there was a young Turk revolution, which everybody applauded. Now, everyone is equal on paper. There's a constitution.
Mm-hmm.
There's a parliament. Turks are hugging Armenians. Armenians are hugging Turks. Greeks are hugging Turks. Everyone's hugging everybody.
Mm-hmm.
Happy days are here again. Everyone's dancing in the street. And it looks like now the empire is going to be democratic, Western style, and so forth. unfortunately, what happened is between 1910 and 1913, eventually dictatorial Turks, who didn't believe in democracy, pushed out the good, democratic-minded, liberal Turks, pushed them out of government, mm-hmm. and the fascistic, right-wing Turks took over, who couldn't stomach the idea that in parliament you can have, in parliament you actually have to sit there and listen to an Armenian debate you, a Greek debate you, Arab debate you, a Jew debate you, and you're all equal, and then you vote. After centuries of being the absolute rulers, it was hard for some of them to accept
it. Of course,
So what happened is, when World War I came in August 1914, that right-wing Turkish government decided to eliminate the Armenians.
And when you say he decided to eliminate the Armenians, or they decided to eliminate the Armenians, tell us about how they decided to do this and what the process. See, and the reason I'm asking this is because I know that in many, we can look at any of the Holocausts or any of the genocides or any of the terrible points in history, that the people knew it was coming. Some people sat by passively and watched it. The people that were affected knew it was coming. But it's something like once you find out about it, it's already going downhill, and you really there's not much you can do about it. So tell me, what was the progressive step?
There were some warning signs. A minor massacre of 20,000 took place in 1909. There was animosity in the air, but for a genocide to happen, it has to be organized by a government, and the government has all the resources that average people don't have. So what happened is in April 1915, that government decided to get rid of the Armenians as a way of stopping this democratic trend, stopping Armenians from eventually asking for autonomy. What we call in the U.S. Mm-hmm. federalism. Mm-hmm. Armenians wanted, in the districts where they were majority, they wanted
to have representation.
As separate states and provinces like we have here. Mm-hmm. Not independence, but what it would be the equivalent of federalism. Oh. And the Young Turks did not want that. Other people wanted federalism too. Another reason to get rid of the Armenians was because many Armenians were prominent in the economy. Most Armenians, 80%, were poor peasants, but there was a good number up on top who were industrialists, bankers. In one city, out of 34 bankers, 31 were Armenian. So Armenians were prosperous, they were good businessmen, engineers, even the top chef at the palace for the Sultan was an Armenian. The accountant for the Sultan was an Armenian. Mm-hmm. The Ottoman mint that prints the money, the supervisor was Armenian, and so forth. So this created some jealousy that if a Turkish general, let's say, wants to retire and wants to go into business, he would face stiff competition from Armenians, Greeks, and Jews, who over the years had become prominent in business because they couldn't do anything else. They couldn't be a soldier, they couldn't
be a
government official.
So they had to open their own business.
Christians and Jews had become the backbone of the Turkish economy. Now when Turks also want to, they get Western education, and now when a general retires, he wants to maybe open a business or go into banking or something, but those areas are dominated by Jews and Greeks and Armenians.
Now, Jews, you mentioned Jews several times. Jewish people were living there?
Yes. Okay. Very small in number, nowhere near. There were about over 2 million Greeks.
Why were they there?
First of all, in Palestine, Palestine was the original Jewish homeland, of course. So there were about 70,000 in Palestine, but also in other parts of the empire, as Jews were in New York also. Because that's the Jewish diaspora.
Okay.
So they decided to get rid of the Armenians for all these reasons. Another reason was to expand the empire, the Ottoman Empire, into the east toward the Great Wall of China, to link up with the Turks who live in Central Asia. Mm-hmm. That way, by Turkifying the empire, getting more Turkish blood into the empire, the thought was they would strengthen the empire. But who's in the way? we don't have a map here, but if you visualize it, on the way from today's Turkey up to the Central Asia, are about 2 million Armenians sort of in the way. So there are several reasons to get rid of the Armenians from the Turkish government point of view. The way it began is on April 24, 1915.
And that's the...
Right, that's the key date. That day, several hundred of the top Armenian leaders were arrested, and virtually all of them killed without trial. These are members of parliament.
So they just walked into the homes?
Just walked into the homes.
Or the businesses.
Or the businesses, seized them with no, what here we
for
call
no reasons.
Warrant or for arrest, whatever.
Warrant, arrest, or...
No, they seized them, and hundreds of them. And these are the top, including members of parliament. Imagine if our government here, I suppose Clinton would have loved to arrest Newt Gingrich, I suppose.
Well, being a Democrat, I understand him.
right. But he wouldn't dare do that. But the government.
I understand what you're saying.
Yes.
But they must have been very confident.
They had no idea that it was. They knew there
that
was
they could do
the
that.
Air, but to think that a government in the
20- I mean the government
right.
itself had to have been pretty confident that they could
yes.
get away with that.
Yes, they were confident they could get away. Well.
They
get away. They moved so quickly. They moved so quickly. It was very well organized. So in one night, in one day, when you have the top leaders eliminated, what happens now? The rest of the community is unorganized.
They are totally in disarray.
The less educated people are left, the peasants. That was the first step. The next step was they disarmed all the Armenian soldiers in the Turkish army.
The ones that they had...
No, not those. After the 1908 revolution, Armenians, Christians, can now join the Turkish army.
Okay.
Right. Before they could not.
Okay.
They had to be converted to Islam first.
Okay.
But after 1908, there's equality, right?
All right.
So there are Armenians in the Turkish army. They were disarmed, put into labor battalions, and worked to death, and then eventually all killed. Now, who's left in the villages now or in towns? Old men, little boys, and
women and children.
Women and children. Now the order went out to deport them.
I say that
the order went out
to deport them to where?
To deport. The reason given was you have to move tomorrow. We're going to move you
to a better place,
to a different place for your own safety, or because you guys might cause trouble because this is a war zone and the Russian army is coming, and because you're Christian, you might help the Russian army. So we're going to remove you from that area.
Okay.
Now
we're going to have to move faster because
right.
you know 30 minutes is. We need to have another hour for
right.
this one.
But let me finish it. In that process of deportation, horrible things happened. The purpose of the deportation, according to the American ambassador, was extermination. The deportation was excuse to exterminate. One example is Tacy Atkinson and her husband, who was a doctor. One day, her husband, the doctor, saw around one lake, as he's looking, he saw one area where he said there were 10,000 bodies, nearly all women and children, all naked, all mutilated, all butchered.
I've seen.
Imagine one area. Right. Imagine one of 10,000 bodies. So we have 10,000 bodies here, 10,000 there, 5,000 there. By the end of the war, November 1918, there were only about 200,000 Armenians left out of a population of 2 million. Around 200,000 left, and the rest, a few hundred thousand survived. But something like between 1 million and 1.5 million. Were slaughtered or starved to death in some of the most horrible ways you can imagine. Witnesses describe how pregnant women are disemboweled to see what the
So when they were displaced and told to move, many of them did they leave and come to the United States? I know some of them went to other parts of the country, like. Is in Russia and...
Yeah, those survivors, some of the survivors, around 200,000, 250,000 went to Russia, to a region of Russia that was also a part of Armenia. Mm-hmm. And others ended up in Syria, eventually Greece, eventually Paris, eventually the U.S. Mm-hmm. So a lot of Armenians ended up in the U.S. Mm-hmm. Now, they weren't the first Armenians in the U.S. The first Armenian in the U.S. was around 1618. An Armenian was a servant of the governor of Virginia in 1618.
Oh.
So Armenians were brought, even at that time, the colonial period, to develop the silk trade, silk business in Virginia. Okay. So Armenians have been in America a long time, but the biggest wave
genocide. Yeah.
The biggest wave came after the genocide.
So this is the origin of the April 24th, what we call the Armenian Genocide,
right.
The beginning of it. And this is the one that in Glendale we have the, you and I are on the appointed by the city council,
right.
And mayor to, on the memorial committee.
Right.
And
it's a pleasure to be serving with you, by
yes,
the way.
Yes, it's a pleasure to be serving with you as well.
It's fascinating meetings.
It's a yeah, we have some heated heated meetings there, but I think we're coming to some
it looks like
meetings. It looks good. And so this is why I wish we had more time, because I really, there's some more things,
right.
I want to go into the move.
Right, what happened
afterwards. What happened after,
right.
that. So we'll have to have you back.
But that's April 24th, that's why it's commemorated. For every major event, you need a beginning.
You have to, in other words,
it's
a healing thing.
Right.
It's a healing, acceptance and healing thing.
Right. And it's harder to heal in this case when the perpetrator still denies it. That's the thing. It's easier to heal when...
But you must understand the perpetrators will probably never accept it, because, as you know, in America, with,
right.
the slavery, there are people,
right.
who say it didn't happen. There are people who,
right.
say, well, we deserved it because we're too stupid to exist.
Yeah,
and
some,
also,
some say that.
And then there are others that say, well, we were very happy.
Some
we were just...
want to fly the Confederate flag.
And we're very happy people for,
right.
being slaves. So you know, I understand the acceptance
some
part, but we
did. For example, Germany admitted,
yeah.
the Holocaust.
Yes.
They acknowledged it. They apologized.
And I'm going to have to cut you off, because we got to go, and
yeah.
and we're going to have you come back and finish that. And because I know the people, the community, and the Armenian community is working very hard and very diligently and being very successful in doing getting. That healing that you need,
right.
And I'm excited about that and working with that myself. And I just wanted to talk about the fact that you have books, Remembrance and Denial. And this book tells me a little bit about the history of that,
right.
and the denial.
And
so
I have one chapter in this.
Okay, and
book.
Then two others. So I can't tell. I've got to go. So I can't tell them about the other books. So they need to look forward to it. See you next time on Wanda's Cafe. I wish we had more time to tell them about the books, because they're fascinating.